Hello, folks, and welcome back once again to Chris Wyatt Africa and the Rugby Ascendant segment here on Chris Wyatt, as well as this will be appearing on the Rugby Ascendant channel later on. Pleasure to have a very interesting guest today. I love getting accomplished people on this channel. Listen, sevens, 15s, rugby league, she's done it all, and she's succeeded at every level. A commentator, by the way, and she's going to get paid a high compliment here, so I'm going to run the risk of being a bit of a sycophantic fan here, but a high compliment for her coverage of the Vancouver Sevens, and I'm looking forward to the Edmonton Sevens this weekend. None other than, now, see, this is going to be a problem. It's an Anglo-Saxon name, but I'm going to mispronounce it because I have this bad German habit, because I speak German, of pronouncing names like Andrea in a German fashion, but I'm sure she goes by Andrea Burk, or also known affectionately as Burkey. How's it going, Berkey? How you doing?
I'm fantastic, and as you can tell, I'm very skilled at mouthing words without having the volume come through the voice if and when needed. It's one of my many broadcasting performance talents.
No, it's listen. You have done quite a bit in rugby. I mean, you've done it all. I mean, when I coordinated Ashley coming to program, and for folks who are curious, I reached out to her because last week during the Vancouver Sevens, which other than the Eagles and their disturbing tendency over the past two seasons to disappear when games matter the most. Sorry, Mike Friday, but but that's a true statement there. But other than that, it was an incredible tournament. I thought that the Blitzbok were dominant from start to finish. I thought the Kenyans, who also have this disturbing habit of being awesome and disappearing at critical moments, disappeared in the final, but nothing against the Blitzbox. They dominated, but Kenya, that All Africa final would have been better. So Kenya, South Africa, and USA seem to be in the pool stage. Amazing. And I listened to your commentary, and I'm sitting here listening, I'm critical. I'm most critical of myself when I listen to commentators like, room for improvement, and maybe I'm like, no, man, this is like spot on. More, give me more. So I was listening to the commentary; it was brilliant. And let people know, I reached out to her through Dolan Stanford, who's a friend of mine. I know Dolan. I used to play for USA Sevens, originally from South Africa, and we have a lot in common anyway. And I've also interviewed Dolan in this program, so that's how I reached out to her, and she responded like really quick. And Dolan's like, I think she'll be keen to do the interview. And yeah, you came right back to me. You're like, well, what should we talk about? I'm like, gosh, with your CV, we could talk forever. So Andrea, it was really cool seeing you. How did you get into rugby? Let's just start with that. Let's start back at the basics. I mean, because Canada and North America, people don't think of rugby that much, although they're starting to. But a lot of folks actually get in as kids here, and people don't realize it. Did you start as a kid, or did you transition from another sport?
I started as a teenager, and like, pay attention to the fact that I have been playing rugby since 1996. So there wasn't a lot of rugby in Vancouver, British Columbia, west coast of Canada. I mean, it wasn't a lot of rugby in Canada for kids at that time, for minis, for youth. And that has really grown ever since. But the first touch point for me and a lot of my contemporaries was to be exposed to rugby through high school programs or through the local clubs.
Well, it's interesting you mention that, because here in the U.S., we've had a bit of a concerted effort over the past few years, and I'm not sure how well it carries over to Canada. I don't think it does, but things like play rugby and girls rugby, moving promote girls getting in rugby, and also into communities that typically where you don't find it, like African-American inner-city communities, that's what play rugby is. Those are nice initiatives. Do this carry over at all to Canada, or do you have something similar, hopefully?
One that comes, there's a couple programs that come to mind. So there's the TURF, which is the Toronto Inner City Rugby Foundation. And then there's also Thunder Rugby that is on the West Coast, being run by former international Sevens 15s Phil Mack, a bit of a household name in Canada. So, and then there's another one, BC Grassroots Rugby, being spearheaded by Clayton Ponga, who is another 15s international as well. And he came over from playing from New Zealand for a number of years. So there are a number of programs being brought up through Canada, reaching all levels of the community. And Canada is a very vast country, right? Like, we have a lot of our population sits really far, fairly far south, closer to the Canada-USA border. And the communities get smaller, a little bit more remote as you move up and north. And, there's some fantastic, absolutely incredible, jaw-dropping initiatives being run by people in different communities. There's on some of you know, on some of the indigenous lands. One story that comes to mind, met a man from Prince Rupert, after the Vancouver Sevens. And, you know, he's just talking about how every once in a while there's these absolute studs, these incredible athletes that come out of these small communities, and they don't get the exposure because, you know, the higher performance places don't have the capacity to go up there. But what is being what is happening between these coaches, these programs that are running these sessions, as well as community support and fundraising support, is that they're able to send athletes down to the bigger centers to get that exposure. And what is so amazing about that is these athletes can get the exposure, they can get a different level of education, and eventually they bring that back into their smaller grassroots communities, and they can really, in my experience, really grow the game and as well the community around them.
Well, you touch on something that's very interesting, and we talk about Canada and about sports up there. I mean, honestly, for sure, you've got issues competing with like hockey, you know, and those smaller communities as you get north up to like to Nunavut was like 10 people living up there in the entire province. It's quite difficult to get a rugby team together, eh?
Well, the good thing about sevens is if you have 10 people, then, you know, you've got a side, and if you can travel or if people come to you, you have a side plus subs.
No, that's a good point there. Absolutely. No, I was just having a little fun with the Canadian accent there. Wasn't my best. So anyway, well, you know, listen, I joke, Canada's, and we love Canada. If it wasn't for Canada, we'd have no television in America. All our TV stars are Canadian. So people forget that.
The funny ones, at least. Yeah.
Yeah. The entertaining ones, at least. Speaking of which, Norm MacDonald just passed away. That was kind of sad. Yeah. He was, yeah. I actually met him once outside a hotel in Washington, D.C. when I came back from Africa for a trip. Yeah, it's a shame. But anyway, let's get away from that and talk about more interesting, not more interesting, but happier things. So are you originally from Vancouver? I know you went to university there, but are you from the Vancouver area?
No. Okay. Listen to this. So I was born and raised in North Vancouver, British Columbia, just across from the downtown core. And then I went to my university all the way on the East Coast at Acadia University, which is in Wolfville, Nova Scotia.
Oh, that's the maritime provinces out there. Wow.
Yeah. 3,500 people in the town when I was going to Acadia. And the population would double during the school year. Yeah. So I did my undergrad out there, came back to Vancouver, and then spent some time in Victoria as I was centralized with the Sevens program. And I did my master's out there at Royal Roads University on Vancouver Island.
Okay, so you've got a long history with Vancouver, but you've also been all the way to the other side of the country too. And now I think you're living kind of in the eastern side, middle. So you've been all over Canada. Now, most Canadians live within about 50, 100 miles of the U.S. border, but have you been north? Have you gone up to place like Nunavut or further up there?
Not yet. That is a bucket list endeavor for me. I would love to go up there. And you know, the beautiful thing about rugby is that it always gives a great excuse to travel. If I've spent some time in the States, I've been all over the world. Really, rugby has provided opportunities for me for higher levels of education, for career opportunities, for travel. Like, there's this global community that can really be born. And you know, and so I haven't been up there yet, but when I did go down and live in the States for a summer, and the very end as well, I did the same thing going to Auckland. The first thing that we do as rugby players is we say, you know, besides where's the bar, is where's the rugby club, right? And this is what I did when I went to Acadia as well. The beauty of sports is that when you go anywhere, there's this ultimate and like unspoken connection. So basically it was like, where's the rugby club? And as soon as I did that, I had a foothold into the city. I had a whole group of friends to show me around. I had a sport to play, and you know, which serves as a really great icebreaker when we're meeting new people. But there's something about rugby, you know, when you meet rugby people and the people who are drawn to the sport itself, it's like without any explanations, without like anything spoken, it's like you. I know who you are. Yep. And I get you. And so I would love to be able to apply that and take that experience, go up into the northern areas of BC, and even up to the territories as well. There's territories, Nunavut. You know, I'm just pausing because I'm reflecting on a couple of Canadian national athletes that are out of the Northwest Territories and the Yukon and doing some incredible sport initiatives up there.
Well, you're absolutely right about the nature of rugby. And that's one of the reasons why I love the game. And I tell people stories about it all the time, but let me bring a comment here very quickly. Now, Nick Muller says, no offense, but Andrea is the best looking rugby guest so far on the program. Okay. Look at that. So there's a nice compliment there.
Still have my teeth and I still have my nose and I have a little bit of a cauliflower ear, but
it's not noticeable on the camera. So that's good. So you didn't wear a scrum half or didn't wear a scrum hat, did you?
No, I would wear mouth guards and I have broken my nose. And this is one of my favorite stories because, and it still kind of baffles me a little bit. So I was in Auckland, playing for college rifles. We were in the final and I can't remember how I broke it, but it was like, it got smashed pretty hard. And so what do I do? Right. I'm still playing. It hurts, whatever.
Yeah.
But I start going into tackles like this because I'm scared. And I'm being not only completely inefficient, but I look like a bit of an idiot doing that as well and completely exposing myself to more
injury. Yeah, it's crazy.
And I just had to have this little sit down, like proverbial sit down talk with myself, like middle of three quarters of the way into the first half. And it was like, Andrea, this is ridiculous. Like, get your head into it. Like, put your head down and tackle, or put your head down and go through the ruck. So eventually I just started dropping my shoulder, which is actually the safest way to tackle, like head down, eyes up, shoulder in.
Yeah.
And, you know, but when we get injured or when we get scared, and we see this at the younger levels all the time, we start tackling like this, which is the most vulnerable place to go.
Not a good position for a tackler, to say the least. That's for sure. That's, you know, it's, and you're right. You know, it's funny because people ask me, I want to get back to that. I want to say a story about, we're quickly about Australia, but before I get to that, it's funny because people who don't know the game, who I introduced to the game of rugby. First off, I've never introduced anybody to rugby that didn't like it, didn't fall in love with it. That's the first thing. Mm-hmm. Second thing is that when people ask about the game, they said, isn't it dangerous? I mean, they're not wearing pads. Well, there's a little bit of shoulder padding on some players these days, but they're not wearing pads and you know, that sort of thing. I said, well, I mean, if you're in the scrum, you know, you got a danger getting a cauliflower ear, getting some nicks and getting dug up there. But if you tackle correctly in rugby, it's designed to reduce the impact and make an effective tackle. But we see players oftentimes, especially younger kids, making tackles, thinking they're playing American football, and you can't do that. You've got to be very focused on how you're doing it. So it's a shame to hear about your nose, but it looks like it healed fine. I never knew your nose is broken, so that's good to see. Unlike Franco Mustard, whose nose looks like a slope now, man, he keeps breaking that thing. But let me tell you the quick story. I was talking about the nature of rugby. So in 2011, you're talking about, you know, when you go a place, you look for the rugby people, that sort of thing. I was in New Zealand for the Rugby World Cup in Wellington. I didn't know anybody in Wellington at all. I stayed at a hotel and I looked it up online. It was called the Amora Hotel. And it said a rugby special. I'm like, okay, I'm a Roop. They're going to take advantage of me. So I looked and it averaged out to about, I don't know, about $112 New Zealand night, which is pretty good. It was right in the Inner Harbor there. And it was the best hotel in Wellington. I had no idea. So I just booked in a line. I get there. I was pleasantly surprised. Turns out they put me on the floor with the Argentine team who were there for 5 days. So for 5 days, I was hanging out with the Argentine players, having a breakfast with them, and everything was kind of cool. And then I walked downstairs with my Springbok jersey on because I'm a South Africa fan and an Eagles fan. But so I walked downstairs and people start greeting me in Afrikaans because the South African High Commission leased the conference center on the ground floor across from the check-in desk. And they're like, come over. And I'm like, hey, probably me Afrikaans me. I don't speak Afrikaans. Like, yeah, you do. You just spoke it. So they dragged me in. And they're like, hey, and they're like, give me food and free beer all the time for the days I was there. And that's part of it. Just shows the community sort of thing. But when I went to a game, I watched the Eagles play the Wallabies. We scored early, but then got it trounced, of course, in Wellington. But I'm sitting next to this couple from Australia. And of course, nobody gets married in Australia. So they're partners, you know, and they're both in the Australian Air Force and I was in the Army. So we start having a conversation. We're chatting about the game and everything. And he goes, hey, listen, I know the captain of the American team. If you want to hang out with them at the hotel afterwards, I'll give him a call and see if, you know, if they're going to be there. I'm like, yeah, okay, sure, whatever. So I figured he's just shooting a breeze, right? So we walk back downtown. It's a long walk if you've been to Hamilton, and you may have been there, but if you walk from the stadium back downtown, it's a long walk. And we walk, we find an Irish pub. So we're all like pig and slop. We're having a good time in the Irish pub. We're drinking. People are three sheets to the wind, having a good time. And he kept talking about his friend. He'll get back with me. And I thought that he's just BSing. I'm like, I started thinking to myself after a few beers, how does he know the American captain? He's from Australia. Well, it turns out that night, an American who's also an Australian was playing as the captain because Todd Clever was being rested for the Italian game. Anyway, so we get ready to leave, and I think it's just BS. I'm going to go home. And he goes, no, they're at the hotel. You want to go? I'm like, okay, what if I got those? So we walked to the hotel, and there's the U.S. national team. I walk in the hotel. Everybody's there. We took pictures. We had a great time. We drank. We ate. It was a blast. That's the nature of rugby, even national side rugby and professional rugby. Rugby players are approachable, and people want to hang out. My first ever rugby game I went to, one side got destroyed like 57-0. But when the game was over, everybody got together. They had a beer. There's no animosity. And that's what I like about rugby. That kind of goes to your story about, you know, you find the rugby folks out there.
So, Chris, let me ask you this. When you were in the same space side by side with some of these international rugby players, did you ever get the feeling that it was like, oh, you're a little bit smaller, more manageable than you look like you're on TV? Or it's like, whoa, that is like, you're a behemoth. Like, you're a lot bigger than you look like on TV.
It's a really good question, Andrew. This, by the way, this is why I call this segment, it's Rugby Ascendant, but it's also the Indaba Conversation with Chris, because these are interviews, but it's more of a conversation back and forth. So I appreciate that question. Well, that night, I was kind of amazed. Now, remember, it's 2011, so it's a few years ago. I was kind of amazed that I was taller and as skinny as I am, bulkier than a lot of the guys on the U.S. national side. Now, I have been to games like Atlanta where Johan Mumpson is there, and he's a big guy, and a lot of guys. So, I mean, it's these days it's interesting because, and that's what I like about rugby, anybody can play. You can be Cheslin Kolbe, like 2 inches off the ground, and hit people like a ton of bricks. I mean, he hits unbelievably hard. The guy's amazing. We saw the same thing in sevens. Like Ronnie Brown from South Africa was bringing it. The guy is a cancer survivor. He's fully recovered now. And he hits like Cheslin Kolbe, and he weighs like 30 kilos, right?
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah, it's absolutely crazy.
He was unstoppable.
Yeah. So why did... Devald Uman was also hitting pretty hard. And when he hits hard, you see it because he's got the dreadlocks and they fly all over the place. It's pretty cool. I like that.
And they do it with a smile. You know, that I think is like as hard and as rough and as tumble and as physical and as like gritty as rugby is, the best games that I've ever had and being able to watch the Blitzbacher in Vancouver Sevens is the most enjoyable. You get to do all of that hard, gritty hitting stuff, but then you kind of do it with a smile, and it shows so much character and so much of like the cheekiness that comes with the sport.
Well, it's funny because when I came, my last assignment in Africa before I came back to work at the War College, my last tour on active service, I came back and I contacted a local club in Harrisburg and said, hey, I'd like to get involved with your club. I see you've got a club. I want to promote rugby. I mean, you want someone to help you raise money or assistant coach or, you know, just come out and help out in some way, you know. And they're like, you're in Africa. You're a rugby guy, huh? Hey, listen, we need somebody in our sevens team. Like, hey, I'm 50 years old. Those days are past me. I mean, I'm not playing sevens anymore. I don't have the constitution to run up and down the field like that. I'd be the guy getting burned because I get faked out. Now, 10, 15 years ago, I could still keep up. 20 years ago, I could be a stud. But now, sevens is a track meet. I can't keep up with that. So let me deal with the super chat real quick, and then we switch to how you play different types of rugby. So Brett Sessoms just gave a super chat, said $10 super chat, said, your guest's thoughts on Ruben Dehaze and his performance for the Eagles. Now, that's a good question versus Canada. My parents have visited Victoria, Canada, and loved it. Well, yeah, I've been to Victoria too. I absolutely loved it too there, although I did experience something really bizarre there, but it's unrelated to Victoria. And they taught me the importance of the U.S.-Canada Alliance. Oh, U.S.-Canada Alliance is critical. That's the reason we weren't nuked during the Cold War, because of NORAD. But your thoughts on Ruben Dehaze and the Eagles versus Canada. Did you watch those test matches or no?
I did not catch them. I was taken away for work, which was upsetting. So I was watching the play-by-play come across the social media. I have a couple of thoughts on the games in general, but I wouldn't be able to speak to Ruben's performance.
Well, let me give my thoughts on Ruben's performance, and then you just give your comments on the game in general. I thought Ruben Dehaze in the second game was absolutely brilliant. He distributed the ball very well. He got to the breakdown quickly. It's very frustrating when guys are forming the ruck and there's no one coming over there to pick up the ball, and the other guys do a counter ruck, come back and get it, or you get accused of holding on to it. So Dehaze was all over it. He did a great job recycling, and his drop kick was awesome. He did a drop kick. I love it. It's visions of Joel Stransky, 1995, and he did a drop kick. kick. It really put the Canadians in the back foot because they had some good move in the ball. They got some good kicking and were getting good position. And then and the U.S. Gets it up the field, and Ruben just out of the blue, not expected. I talked to Gary Gold. Gary said he missed every kick in practice. Every single drop kick he missed in practice. And so he took the risk and he made it. But anyway, that's my thoughts on Ruben. Second game, much better. He did okay in the first game, but Canada brought it in St. John's. It's Swiler or Swillers or Swiler. They brought it. USA made so many mistakes, but that does not undercut Canada's performance. They earned that victory, as I told Gary Golden. He agreed with 100%. But your thoughts on the series in general, Berkey?
To win on an aggregate score from a loss out of game one is not an easy feat to do. I do believe that in a two game series where teams are fairly evenly matched, the mental game is almost as important, perhaps more important than the tactical and the physical strength game on the field, right? The win in Newfoundland is something that the Canadian men will remember for a lifetime. Those moments, those games as players, they just stick with us. And the feeling at the end of it where you've just put everything out, and you're also getting that reward at the end of it. And the iconic picture for me was them clapping, thanking the fans in Newfoundland. And Atlantic Canada has some crazy passion, some crazy power. So I'm not too sure that there wasn't a 16th, 17th and 18th player on the field with them from the support that was coming in from the fan base. And then speaking to the Eagles in the second game, to come back from behind, win on a 9-point differential aggregate, like, that goes to show something for their preparation, for how they were able to shift their mindset to take on Canada in the second game. The challenge for Canada, having come off of the first game, is let's not get cocky. We didn't earn that win easily, and we need to start again. And I think something that happens in the brain is when you get the wins, it's like, oh, like, okay, we just, it's the primacy and recency effect, right? The recency is that we won. But the last thing you remember is that we won the game, we came out on top. But typically we tend to forget what happened at the beginning of the game, what happened at the 20th minute, the 40th minute, the 60th minute, like within each ruck, and like how hard we had to put our foot in to tackle, and the real big challenges of it. We just remember what we want to remember at the end of it. So the challenge for the Canadian men in the second half of the series would have been to start fresh, start over, forget what happened, and come at USA Eagles as hard as they did the first time. For USA, it's about like shaking it off, digging deep and saying we can do better. And we now have something to prove. And that is a very dangerous opponent to face.
No, it's a really great point, Andre. And I haven't heard many people put it in those terms. I've certainly thought about it like that, but I like how your approach to that is that, I mean, it's Scott Lawrence, who's the head coach of Rugby ATL and Major League Rugby. I've interviewed him many times and I cover their games. He's always like, okay, next game, whether they just won a big game or they get trounced. And some people are like, dude, you just beat the Giltinis in Atlanta. Aren't you excited? Or you just beat Rudy for the conference. He's like, no, I got to focus on the next game. And Gary Golden seems to have the same approach for the Eagles. We did talk about the games and the tests this summer that have gone on against England, how they showed up really well in the second half in that England game. And then they just disappeared in Ireland. Not my words, Gary's words. I mean, it's just they were really not happy with that performance. But you can't dwell on that. I think rugby is a game where, more than any other sport, you can't dwell on what's happened, whether you're successful or not. Look at the Wallabies. The Wallabies did it right. The Wallabies eked out a win, a deserved win, eked out a win against the Springbok with Quade Cooper's 23 points, his lifetime game. Amazing performance there. And then they come back the next week and they don't rest on their laurels. Not only did they beat the Springboks, the world champions, and knock them out of the number one rankings, but they obliterated them. The Springboks, I'm a diehard Springbok fan, but I have been calling them the Walking Dead for the past week. And the Walking Dead need to wake up in Townsville in Australia this weekend, where the 100th test match between the All Blacks and the Springboks is going to be unpleasant. But the Wallabies did exactly what you're talking about. They didn't focus on the last game. They were happy they won. They prepped for the next game, and they not only beat the Springboks, but they did it in better fashion.
Yeah. And so it's like, we can't get caught up in the memories. We can't get caught up in the what was and the what ifs. It just takes us out of reality. And I felt it as a player myself. And I want to say that it can be quite dangerous because you're going into the next game because you're facing an opponent who you think you know. You're not taking a sober approach and look at the opponent that you're actually facing on the day. And that's where sports is so much fun, is because not to over emotionalize a win, not to become attached or over emotionalize a loss. And I think that's something that the players and the coaching staff really have to do, is take it is what it is. And let's move on to the next one. You know, as fans, fans get to be able to ride that emotional roller coaster a little bit and live in the glory and to tell the stories. And that's something that players can do as well, but just not not in and around game time. Living in the glory is for the locker room and like for retirement. otherwise it's about being focused and keeping your feet on the ground.
Folks, you're listening to Chris Wyatt Africa, the Rugby Ascendant, here on Chris Wyatt Africa. It's a pleasure to have you join us today. My special feature guest is none other than Canadian superstar rugby player and analyst, and that is Andrea Burk, or Burkey. And I just got another super chat. Let me address that. And then I want to actually, let's go back and roll the clock back and let's live a little bit on your laurels and talk about some past glory. You're not playing right now. I'm focusing on a game. So I want to do that. Brett Sessoms gave another super chat. He's really enjoying this session. He says, who is your guest surprise international men's rugby team? Shocked that they're doing so well. Mine is Ireland. They have shocked me. Well, I'm not shocked by Ireland, but that's an interesting question Brett's asked. Do you have an international men's side that you're surprised? And by the same token, let's not be one-sided. Do you have a women's side that's performing better than you expected right now?
Okay. Well, my men's side is the Argentinian men's 15s team. Also sevens, I think, as a program. And, maybe it's not a shocker or a surprise because I've been watching them for a little while. And I just think they bring such fire, such unpredictability to be playing against. I think they're a really exciting side to watch. And, at the World Cup, they're at any World Cup in any international match, they're actually quite dangerous and teams can't sleep against them.
Yeah, that's a good point. I would agree. The Pumas are really something else. And their addition to the rugby championship, some poo-poo that, but I think it was really helpful for them. But we can remember that Argentina has shown up in the quarterfinals, I think in a semifinal at the Rugby World Cup in the past. What about on the women's side? Is there a women's team that surprises you at all? Are you keeping up with the women's game?
I think France as a nation is a force to be reckoned with. Historically at World Cups, they've, consistently in that bronze medal placing, in the semifinals, have really yet to crack a final, but they've been putting a lot of time into their sevens program, a lot of time into their women's program period. And they have a really outstanding bunch of athletes. And so they're an exciting team to play against and an exciting country to play in. The French will get behind anything, they'll cheer for anything. And they just love their sports.
Well, they do. And you look at professional rugby, that's where a lot of big money's at for the male athletes who play professional rugby, go play in the French league. And a lot of South Africans, of course, are there, and others, they do quite well. Now the French, they love rugby. And when I first got introduced to rugby, I had no idea they even knew what rugby was, and they were actually a powerhouse. But the women's side, yeah, they're very good. But I will say this, let's return to, we'll get with Sherman and Mr. Peabody and jump in the Wayback Machine. We're going to go back to 2014 at Stade Jean Bouin and the 2014 final. Now, you and I were talking off camera, and that's when I discovered Magali Harvey and became a huge fan of hers. I did see you there, but I didn't know you, but I saw you on the pitch. The 2014, Canada gets silver. You guys, you're very impressive. You get to the final, and you don't manage the final, but in that game against France, Magali Harvey proved to be a little too much for the French defense. And one of the most amazing tries in my recollection, that's a try that, I mean, there's a lot of tries in history that stand out. Jonah Lomu with a lot of tries, but Magali Harvey's try in that game, I was just jumping up and down, and it still sparks me. Were you on the pitch for that, that try? And did you play a role in that?
Yes, I was number 12. Our forwards did what they needed to do, what they knew they could do. And, you know, won the ball at the head, turned over the scrum, got pushed back into the feet of number eight, Kelly Russell, and our sub in for our sub in at nine, you know, Alyssa Allery comes out of fullback, and our scrum half got injured. And, you know, so Allery is in at nine, and she picks and goes off of the back of the scrum. So I was the first one to, and because we were in the defensive position that we were, our fly half was on the blind side and getting set up, you know, getting set up to defend, getting set up for a kick, but Allery picks and goes to the right. And so I was the first receiver off of the scrum. Basically, I thought I had a gap. So and I thought I had a gap. So I attacked first, and then, you know, the French defense closes in. Well, that gap's no longer there. So now we need to shift it to Marchak at 13. And then Marchak just puts a nice flat pass to Magali Harvey. And the whole thing with the Canadian side in that tournament was we're all playing to our strengths, right? So my strength is attack because, and draw on defenders. Mandy at Marchak at 13, you know, she has the exact same skill ability. And Magali Harvey, she's all about speed, pace, you know, in space. So, you know, and just again, the way that the defense was set up, we were able to attack that. And Harvey did such a great job of exploiting the space and just turning defenders inside and out. It's kind of like a video game, right? On the way out. I do have a copy of that. I do have a copy. I don't know if I can share my screen if you have time for it, but I do have a copy of that try on my computer.
If it's your own copy, not going to get me a copyright strike. That's fine. Is it your own copy?
Oh, no, yeah, fair. No, it's it was from the World Rugby feed.
Yeah, no, I might get a copyright strike on that. So, okay. So we'll just hold off that. But no, listen, people go there. I'll put a link to it and actually put it in the description of this thing. Check it out. But listen, okay, very modest of you.
It's on YouTube.
It's easy on YouTube on the World Rugby Channel. That's very modest of you. When I talk about the try and I talk about Magali's Harvey try, for me, it starts at the scrum, winning that scrum. That's where it started. And you just described the whole thing. That was almost like your main commentator describing it through. It's brilliant and how you guys did it. Let me ask you this question, because that try was the team's try, because you guys broke the French back in that. You could just see it. Just the life just ooze right out of them there. Once you off, when you made that, you offload the ball and now you're trailing, you're following the play, right? At what point do you like, oh, we got this. Was it quick or because defenders were coming at her, they had the angle and it looked like she might get stopped. But at some point we're like, oh, fingers crossed, we're going to get this. Or are you like, you know, trying to chase just in case you had to get the ball again?
There are a couple of thoughts went through my head. One, well, first of all, let's talk about the cross cover from France's right side wing. Like, she almost got Magali. It was like her chase down was absolutely admirable. But I do remember passing the ball and the ball going to Marchak and then Harvey. And then like having this thought in my head being like, oh man, she's like, I'm never going to get there, because she was like shot out of a cannon, right?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Magali was just gone. And I was like, she's so far away from me. And, you know, and that try started I would have started my run within the 22, like 10, 12 meters off of our defensive try line. And so we're running 75 meters, but there was a part of me that was like, this is not I didn't think it was a sure try until she put it in, because you never know what happens with that cross cover defense. Right. And it's like, I just know that my job on the field is if there is a tackle, I need to be there. You know, I need to be there for a ruck, especially if it's a backs ball. And with that cross cover defense, it did put, you know, a little bit of fear in me that it's like, we need to get there and we need to support that, maintain the ball on that ruck. And if we could have done that, then we would have had the try, you know, then we would have had the try, because we would have had the support and the numbers and the open space as well as the momentum, you know. But Magali was able to evade any threat of tackle and just, you know, finish it off herself, which was in the video, in the clip, you know, there's just so much joy. And I have to say the commentary on that is like, she's being shouted to the line. I can't see who it is, you know, but like the absolute enthusiasm that the commentators brought to that scene and having seen it on the replay in the video is as memorable as being on the field in real time.
No, you're absolutely right. And commentators really make a big difference in a game. They really do. I enjoy Dolan's commentary. He's always making up nicknames for people, and they're usually spot on. It's pretty good. I really enjoyed your commentary last weekend, and you'll be doing the Edmonton Sevens this weekend, correct?
Yes, correct.
Okay, so I'm looking forward to that as well. I'm going to have a little more difficult time because I do live reaction. You know, a lot of people on YouTube, they put the game up, and then I do color commentary, and I do play-by-play all by myself responding. Some people tune in to watch it because they enjoy my enthusiasm, but I'll be covering the United Rugby Championship games this weekend, Leinster against the Bulls, and then Western Province. So I'll be up at 3 a.m. covering the Springboks All Blacks, and hopefully I won't be in tears after that's over. Then I'll be doing,
No tears, period. Tears of joy, tears of happiness.
Oh, tears of joy are fine, but I'm worried about tears of sadness. I mean, I'm worried about having to cut up my Springbok jersey, so to speak. No, I'm not doing that. But so then I'll do the Western Province game at 8 a.m. So it's going to be a long day for me tomorrow. And then I do my news program. After my news program, I'm doing it early so I can do the Bulls and Leinster. Leinster were the champions last couple of years. They ought to be a really good game. But yeah, you're right. The commentary, it can make all the difference in the world. I don't know if you've seen this. This one guy, we're going to run out of time because we only got about 15 minutes before you have to go. You have another engagement, but so I want to get a couple more things, but what's this guy's name? He does these sports little cartoons and stuff. He took the Rugby World Cup 2019 commentary and he puts cartoons on it, and he takes people's comments. And I don't know if you know who I'm talking about. I can't think of his name off the top of my head, but he puts it together. He goes, into the wind, it's more difficult than it looks. And he's got a cartoon of a guy, you know, taking a leak and it's coming back on him.
Hilarious.
Dolan, when Dolan was in the game, Gareth Davis. And he's yelling, and he's surprised. It shows you how commentators, you put little scenes with, it's just amazing, but it really does add to the game.
Yes. And like one of the joys for me at the Vancouver Sevens, you know, and is being in the moment with the players. And for me to plan something and try to fit something in, it just always falls flat, right? So to really be engaged and to watch the game, and like you're saying with the Dolan call, like he's like, oh my god, you know, like we get into it as much as the fans do, and you know, to just go spontaneously and see what the game and the players bring us, that's when it's the most fun, that's when it's the most electric and engaging.
No, absolutely. It really makes all the difference in the world. And it's just funny. You listen to commentary and euphemisms and things like that. They just roll off you because you're accustomed to the game. But then when you see someone pull that out and put it against you, like, oh, that's actually hilarious. Yeah. You don't realize it during the game. So it's like off the floor, you know, and so someone's just picking up the ball. And in the cartoon, he's got a guy picking up the pie that he spilled on the floor. He's eating it. So off the floor, funny stuff like that. But here's a question that's very interesting. And I don't want to put you on the spot, so you don't have to answer this if you don't want to, or you can avert it. But I asked Gary Gold yesterday and Gary answered it. And that's fine. But
I have to answer it.
Well, there you go. But then, now you're on the spot. So this will be my last interview ever with Andrea Burk, folks. No, I might be done with Gary Gold too. No, I'm just kidding. But
yeah, you returned your call since?
Yeah, no, just kidding. No, but Paulie, who's in South Africa, he's a firefighter in South Africa. He said, if I can ask you about your thoughts on the new laws. So, I mean, I didn't realize this. I mean, I keep up with World Rugby and I keep up with the game, but I didn't realize they're going to experiment with new laws in the midst of a Rugby World Cup qualifier. It kind of surprised me. So this thing that really torqued me off is that, okay, so we go across. It's a try. Can't really see clear. It was held up. Okay, fine. 5 meter scrum. What? What do you mean 5 meter scrum? No, of course 5 meter scrum, right? Well, no, that's not the prop now. They didn't give you the 5 meter scrum. Now it's a goal line dropout for the defending team. That seems incredibly harsh because the official can't clearly see, even with the TMO. I mean, there's bodies all over the place. It might have been a try. Oftentimes it is, but you don't get the try because you can't see it. And now the defending team gets rewarded and gets to kick the ball. And Canada kicked the ball 46 meters. The Americans are stunned. The Canadians run down the field, pick the ball up, and then they score a try short. It's a 10-point swing. That hardly seems just. And with that buildup, I'll let you comment on that rule.
Well, I'm going to take the other side of the coin.
Here we go.
I actually think that it rewards the attacking side.
How?
Under certain conditions, right? So it's like, so the defenses have done a great job.
Hold on. Did you just run in the Canadian elections? You sound like a politician now.
No, I love it because it brings this little essence of rugby league into the game.
But see, you played rugby league.
Momentum, it keeps the pace up. So I think we'll see a couple things happening with this. So like you said, Canada had the ability to pace it 46 meters down the field, and they were on their, they were fired up from holding the ball, stopping what could have been a try. And now that's a dangerous opponent to deal with. They pace the ball down 46 meters. They know what they're doing. They have the wheels and the wings to go and get it. And then they score. Meanwhile, you know, USA is sitting there licking their wounds, saying, oh man, that was held up. Oh, that sucks, right? No, they've got to get back into the game, because that goal line dropout can 100% be another attacking opportunity for the Eagles, or, you know, for the team that is in the on-field place to receive the ball. You know, who doesn't love the space and the take on a kickoff? You're running at it, you're going up in the air. If you have good momentum going forward, you're going to land on the front foot, and then and you can stuff the defense. And then, you know, in the same breath, how much fun is it to chase down your own kick and to put that pressure and potentially turn it over? I think it's exciting. I support it 100%.
Spoken in a completely unbiased view from Canada's Andrea Burk on the new laws. No, I like your take on it, but this was the perfect, this first instance of me viewing this taking place is, I would argue, the best instance for my argument against it, although your point makes a lot of sense. The USA got completely punished for that just because someone couldn't see if it was touched. Now, it may have been held up, and I don't know. It probably was held up. It's hard to say, but it was weird. How does it get held up from the back of a ruck? That was a driving maul. I mean, a rolling maul that was going in there and was held up. That's a really unusual circumstance, but I'll accept that it was held up. We couldn't see. But, man, what a turn of events. And you're right. Canada earned it. They were ready for it. I mean, but man, that just sucks. I mean, of course, we were unaware that the Canadian Weather Service had adjusted the winds to give them a little push on that kick, you know, from behind. No. But anyway, so that's one law. Now, the other law that got some attention in that game, and I'm kind of torn on this one. I don't think I like this law either, but this one's the 50-22, where if you kick it and it like bounces like one time and then goes into touch, you get the ball back. It's like kicking on a penalty. That's kind of weird to me. Any thoughts on that law?
Yeah, to me, again, it's about creating an exciting, attacking, heavy game, right? It's to be able to keep players on the front foot, keep the fans engaged. We're always seeing these new trial laws come in. You know, there's this swinging pendulum that happens. And there's a comparable that I can give in sevens when I finish this thought, right? So it's like the game is always evolving. The whole idea is, if you score points, more points than the opposition, you win the game. So what happens? Teams create this awesome attacking strategy. They start to score more points. Defense starts to go, wait a minute, we're getting exposed here. We need to be better on defense in these areas. Those now opportunities are shut down. So the attack now needs to find a new way to score points, right? So there's always this little give and take as far as attack and defense and strategies create all these little adjustments. So I think that these laws are playing into those adjustments as well, and just making for more ball in play, more exciting games on attack, you know, less conservative defensive goal line stances. And so the comparable in sevens that I'm referring to, which I believe we saw a lot of in Vancouver Sevens this weekend, is that on the penalty, fewer teams were going for the quick tap. I think it's the defense has been able to get set, the tap and go on the penalties. Like, I think defense, you have attack has all seven players, one player with the ball, they tap it and run. And the defense has been able to adjust and capitalize on that. So what we're seeing now more in sevens is teams are opting for the scrums. Well, now all of a sudden, three defenders are getting pinned in the scrum, you know, the bigger, harder, heavier tacklers, and which is giving more and more space for the out and out flyers in the backs to play off of the scrum. And actually a lot, so there's a fair number of tries that were being scored off of it. So it made for really exciting games.
No, absolutely. Vancouver was amazing. Let me get to a couple super chats here real quick. Brett did another one. He wants your thoughts on the USA's 29 Rugby World Cup performance. I don't know if you watched the USA and Japan. I was at three of their games in the pool stage and then all the spring. But I did. I had 18 games scheduled in 30 days. I wrote 12 articles that were published on the World Cup. And I missed my 18th game because that was Italy versus the All Blacks, and Typhoon Hagibis caused a cancellation of that. But it wasn't my last game. My last game was USA Tonga. So your thoughts on that. But before we get to Leah Van Janssen van Rensburg, she's in South Africa. She's a lovely lady. And she says she loves Andrea's passion for the game, as infectious as yours, Chris. So your thoughts on the 2019 USA performance in the World Cup. And thank you from me as well, Leah Van.
Well, I can still speak to the World Cup in general. You know, you mentioned the typhoon, which brought out a lot of human interest stories, a lot about the background of rugby, you know, the values of rugby and how they came through in the crisis that was the typhoon Hagibis that was coming through there. The Japanese hosts, you know, in Tokyo and beyond, were just absolutely, you know, absolutely enthralling. Learning all, I have goosebumps, learning all of the other nations' national anthems and singing them at every single event. Like, can you think of another sporting event that has happened in?
No. And also at those games, because I was at those stadiums, they reserve seats for school children. Schools came in mass in their school uniforms. And it was a really interesting family touch to the event. I really, really enjoyed it. And I sat everywhere. I sat in great seats. I sat in crappy seats for the games. It cost a lot more money. Yeah. And I paid like in four tranches. You know, I bought my tickets over the course of 2 or 3 years. But it was really amazing. Japan was an amazing host. They were fantastic. Absolutely amazing there. As far as USA performance, any thoughts on that? If not, I'll give my comments on it real quick. For the 2019, I would say this. Gary Gold's Chargers played far better than the table shows. They finished 0-4, but they played their heart out against England. They were overmatched, and it wasn't long before they were out of the game, but they never gave up, and they made some great plays in that game. And so that was a great performance, I thought. The game against France, the French fans were wetting their nappies. I'm telling you, the 60th minute of the game, we could have still won that game. I had a bunch of French people, because I was sitting with the family of the USA team. I know Hanko Hammershuis. And his mom had tickets. So I had a ticket, but they had better seats. So I moved down to that. And so I'm sitting there, and there's all kinds of French fans around us. And they were very loud and vocal. But around the 40th minute after the second half started, they started getting quiet. And up to the 60th minute, they were very nervous because the Eagles brought it. They were outmatched, but they played out of their skin and played above themselves. And the Tonga game that I went to, they had the lead in the first half, but had some, I don't know if it was their head was out of the game, but some breakdowns on defense and a couple line breaks where guys ran all the way back. We had it like on a 3 meter line and Tonga steals it and boom, they run all the way back down and we lost that game. But I think the Eagles acquitted themselves very well, even though they came out 0-4 in the 2019 Rugby World Cup. That's my view on it.
Yeah. Thank you so much. So, you know, the difference between the fans watching it and the players on the ground, like, you know, even though the outcome has been there, I mean, I've been on a winning side of a World Cup experience. I've been on a losing side of a World Cup experience, and both are incredibly memorable, right? And even in the losing side, there's moments, and there's moments in games that do stand out and that I'll always remember. But as a fan watching this stuff, you know, even though the score, you know, perhaps wasn't in our quote unquote favor for USA, right? Like England, they know that they're going onto the chopping blocks. Like England was absolutely outstanding that tournament. Argentina, we've mentioned them earlier in this call, you know, another very strong tier one nation, and so is France, right? Like USA did not have an easy pool to go in. I think as a nation, the Eagles have been improving, before that and ever since then as well. And then, you know, to be able to match up against Tonga and to have a chance and have a go at that. But, you know, so as a fan, what is so exciting is just to see how it goes, right? Even though the score lines were a little bit spread, what you're saying there is like, they still gave us a good ride, right? Yep. You're still hope you just have different goals. Maybe they're not going to beat England, but like, let's put a couple balls over the line. Like, let's rough them up a little bit. Let's have a game. You know, who cares what the outcome is, and let's play. That's when it gets exciting. And I think USA showed up really well in that tournament.
Well, that's kind of what happened with the England test at Twickenham this year. A game I was going to go to, but the COVID hysteria, I couldn't get over there because of quarantine nonsense. I can't afford 2 weeks in a hotel on top of all the travel. But that game in the second half, I was stoked. That was unbelievable. And I did live reactionary commentary. So we're down in the last 3 or 4 minutes. So I got to get a couple things out of here before we get you out of here. First off, I am going to tell you this about the 2019 Rugby World Cup. I'm a Springboks fan first, Eagles fan next. But if the Eagles are playing, I'm rooting for them because I'm an American. And I'm a Velvetius fan. I love Namibia. I've always loved Namibia rugby. It's the amateur guys mostly coming out there. Yeah. So I predicted Namibia's first ever win was going to take place in Japan because Canada was a wounded duck. They barely made the tournament. They had to go through the repage. They were suffering. And I was predicting Namibia was going to beat them. But anyway, so I just to share it with you. So two things here really quickly want to get to. First off, I want to ask you if you'd like to come back, or you don't have to answer the question, but you're welcome to come back maybe next week and do a wrap up, a shorter discussion about the Edmonton Sevens so we can talk about it. And then before we get to that, people need to know. I don't think people know because I didn't get to it. You played sevens, which is a track meet. You paid 15s, which is takes you put your body in there. And you also played rugby league, which is a whole different game altogether, but an interesting one else. You know, the Rugby League World Cup was in England this year. I was supposed to go, and it's been postponed for a year now at the last moment. But you played all those games. Did you have a favorite, or are they all equally as rewarding for you playing?
Yeah, they're all different. They all have their own special memories, right? It's like when you have kids and maybe somebody has their favorite child, but you know, they're all special for different reasons.
Yeah. Well, that's cool. I like how you phrase that. That's a good one. But I got my game there for a second. Yikes. So let's shift in the last couple of minutes we got left here. Edmonton Sevens. Any thoughts about anybody standing out in this tournament coming up potentially? And who do you think is likely to win it? Of course, sevens is a crapshoot. You can predict somebody and then they have one bad game and they're out of it. So any thoughts about this weekend? Because you're becoming
I think Blitzbach is going to will repeat. You know, they might have a target on their back. I'd love to see the Kenyans be a little bit more consistent in their performances just because, you know, they play such a physical game. One of their strides is like three of Ronald's strides, right? I love the what seemed to be starting as a competition, but a friendly competition in the try scorers. So like Angelo Davids and Ronald Brown, right? They're like going 3 for 3 in one game. And then at one point they're like, you take it. No, you take it. This is your try. You know, they're like, they're trying to share the love. They already have enough going for them. I think Blitzbach on the men's side will repeat. Great Britain is going to come out at them hard and strong. And I think the Eagles will likely clean up their performance. We should see them in a semifinal. Ireland just stunned everybody. They didn't have much gas left in their tank. I think they had some of the tightest, hardest matches at the end of day one, the third match, and Hong Kong really took it to them in the quarterfinals. So I think Ireland will clean up as well. So that day two quarterfinal, semifinal matchups will be, you know, exciting nonetheless. But I just think Blitzbach is way too strong and consistent across the entire series. On the women's side, I think Canada will tighten up their game a little bit and look to refine things. I was really impressed with the women's USA Eagles. They, you know, brand new talent. They don't look like they've skipped a beat. And Great Britain, though, they'll have a target on their back. They're showing up with the most experienced squad, both coming from Tokyo and coming from the HSBC series. And, you know, just for a little bit of drama, because, hey, why not? I would love to see the Eagles or the Canadians dethrone the Britons in Edmonton.
No, that'd be awesome. You know, the thing for me in this tournament is I had to do a double take. I'm like, who's that? Who's that? Who's that? Who's that? No Nia Tapper, no Chris Thomas, no Lev Kelter. I'm like, huh? Havilar was there, but I mean, so many new faces. And I don't know if that's because the teams are experimenting, because this is a weird HSBC series this season, or if that's the team going forward, or those guys left the game. It's really, and same on the other side, Madison Hughes is not there. Danny Barrett's not there. Perry Baker, Carlin Isles, these guys, none of them are there. Ben Pinkelman wasn't there. So I mean, Yusefa was there and a couple others, but I'm like, scratching my head for most of these guys and trying to figure out. It was the same with the Blitzbach, but that's Neil Powell. Neil Powell can go into a neighborhood and go, I need sevens players. You look good. You look good. And they go beat everybody. Every year he brings new people on and they're so consistent. We all got to look at what magic elixir that Neil Powell is giving to his charges because it works. Anyway, so Andrea, it's been a real pleasure. You've got to go. So I don't want to keep you longer. It's been a pleasure. Thanks for coming on, especially on short notice. The audience seemed to really enjoy your presence. Good luck with the commentating this weekend. I'll be listening and doing live reaction commentary of some of those games, but not as many because I've got the United Rugby Championship. And we look forward to getting you back on the channel sometime soon.
I had a great time. I would love to come back. Let's talk after Edmonton Sevens.
Absolutely. We'll do that. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Andrea Burk, or Burkey, a sevens player, a 15s player, and a rugby league player. And she's got a day job now, too. Plus, she's a commentator for the sevens series. She was in Rio. She's yeah, there you go. So she's joining the circus there, juggling all those jobs. Andrea, with that, I'm going to put you in a waiting room, and I'm going to lock out the stream. I'll let you get to your next engagement. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a great day.
That's pretty incredible. I hope you enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. Once again, that's why it's called the Indaba Conversation with Chris. It's a conversation, more like a David Frost thing, you know, less than an interview like you get on a news network. I hope you enjoyed it. Amazing conversation. And thank you, Levin. Yeah, she's infectious. She's fantastic. I love the enthusiasm for the game. Clearly loves it like I do. Very accomplished at everything she's been doing. So very impressive. Thank you all for tuning in. I appreciate you joining us here today. I'll be back later for the Night Owls edition. It's Heritage Day in South Africa, or Bride Day, depending on your outlook, or if you're Zulu, it's Shaka Day. Take your pick, but officially it's Heritage Day in South Africa, in which South Africa celebrates its kaleidoscope of various cultures and languages, and we'll talk about that. I'll highlight a couple of ethnic groups in South Africa, and we'll talk about who they are, how large they are, their influence in the country, and also just, you know, as it's a Friday, come on, spot and biki kak, as Ronaldo Chris likes to say. We'll talk a little nonsense here on a Friday afternoon, a Leka Leka Friday. So thank you so much for joining us today. And my many thanks to my guest, Andrea Burk. She was a rock star. Really enjoyed that. Fantastic. And I love the way she recounted that try against France in the Rugby World Cup when she was in Paris in 2014, as we rolled back the clock and we got in the Wayback Machine with Sherman, Mr. Peabody.